Listening Library presents On Top of Glass, My Stories as a Queer Girl in Figure Skating. This is the author, Karina Manta. For my dear friends, Lindsay, Mackenzie, Natalia, and Raina, and for Haley, who is only absent from these particular stories because she was busy at swim team practices. Prologue. In defense of spoilers. I am the kind of person who ruins endings. Before I watch movies, I look up their summaries online. I allow my friends to reveal the best plot twists from their favorite TV shows. When I make attempts at cracking jokes, I go straight for the punchlines. I've been known to flip to the last page of a book before I even read the first. Worst of all, when I tell stories, I can't help but give some bits away too early. I am a menace in the face of suspense. Maybe it's because I have a desire to feel in control. Maybe it's because I'm anxious. My mind likes to busy itself with worst-case scenarios. I just always want to know, to confirm, that things will be okay in the end. Can you blame me? The first time I Googled the words lesbian figure skater, I was a young teenager. I sat at my parents' desktop computer. I opened a new tab in incognito mode, and I clicked the keyboard quietly, even though I was home alone. My initial search didn't conjure any names. Instead, I found a couple of forums that speculated over the sexualities of several athletes. Nothing concrete. I altered my search. Bisexual female figure skaters. Still nothing. I revised again. Gay female figure skaters. Google offered me a list of men. I changed the search entirely. I looked up bisexual politicians, and I looked up bisexual Supreme Court justices, and I looked up the word bisexual alongside every career I ever thought I wanted. At the time, I didn't know what I was looking for. I was sure that I was straight, positive. I thought I was just scratching an itch of curiosity. These days, I know better. I can see what I was trying to do. I was trying to look up another ending, an ending to my own story. I was seeking answers to questions that I was too afraid to ask out loud. What could my life look like? Was my existence even possible? I grew up without knowing a single lesbian in real life, or any queer woman, for that matter. While I scoured the internet that day, I looked for hints at who I could become. But after tapping through pages and pages of search engine results, I didn't manage to unearth even a single clue. For some, the thrill of the unknown might have been exhilarating. But I was not the kind of person who found adventure in uncertainty. I was the kind of person who ruined endings. I shut down my browser and I told myself to forget about the investigation. I told myself to stifle the itch. For years, I felt untethered. Here's the first spoiler of my story. I already warned you, I can't help but give little bits away too early. I could never bring myself to stop searching. The keyboard clicks ingrained themselves into my muscle memory. My hands typed and tapped again and again. I spent countless nights online, trying to make sense of my world, trying to find proof that my story could have a happy ending, or proof that I could exist at all. For a long while, my situation seemed grim. But slowly, as the years passed, a trail of names began to appear during my late-night investigations. With persistence and time, I was given a list. I came across the names of my heroes and the names of my friends and the names of a few brave strangers from all over the world. I found a community and a history that had been hidden. And eventually, as I scrolled along the list, I was able to find my own name. A little blue hyperlink, a buoy thrown to my younger self across the internet's void. If you are someone who needs to be assured, I can assure you, things will be okay in the end. 1. The very beginning. March 20th, 1996, sometime around 1 or 2 in the morning. My story starts at a hospital in Olympia, Washington, on a day that I don't remember. I imagined the hospital was like any other. Cold, white-walled, punctuated by the sharp smell of cleaning supplies. I imagined my parents were taken to a stark room, detailed with pink balloons. Maybe my mother's hair was pulled back into a ponytail. Maybe my father tried to crack a few jokes to ease the tension. From the stories, I know the doctor almost didn't arrive on time. My older brother's delivery took hours of painful coercion. My mom swears she broke her tailbone during the whole process. But I arrived quickly, eager to experience my first bittersweet breath. I arrived so quickly, in fact, that my grandfather, who was a surgeon, almost had to deliver me right on the spot. But luckily, my mother's actual doctor made it just in time to catch my squirming body as I made my grand entrance into the world. I imagine I screamed. It must have felt good to test the capacity of my tiny lungs. The staff members at this particular hospital were accustomed to birthing plump, pale babies with slippery bare skin. I've been told that most of the babies in the neighboring bassinets came out bald as can be. That explains everyone's surprise when I arrived. Small, writhing, and fuzzy. My body was covered in dark, wispy hair. I had a crown of black curls atop my head to match. I'm told it's fairly common for babies born a little premature to find themselves covered in hair. But I must have been an exceptional case. I can probably thank my father for that. I have his especially dark hair. "Wow, look at all that hair," a nurse exclaimed. I imagine her tone suggested more than surprise. Maybe even the tiniest, slightest shade of judgment. My father immediately took offense and decided he and the nurse were bitter enemies. How dare they make fun of my daughter, he thought. He probably even grumbled out loud. I imagine I screamed again, this time with a purpose. The point is this: my body has been an issue my entire life, starting from my very first seconds in the world. After my abrupt arrival, my parents gave me a name. Anna Karina Manta. My first name was a gift from my paternal grandmother, Anna Maria. My middle name was passed down from my mother, Karin. My last name, as you might have already assumed, came from my father. Inside the hospital, my parents whispered my name with soft, cooing voices. The vowel sounds carried the consonants like they were riding the gentle swish of a rocking chair. I was so small, and my thoughts were too fresh and young to be considered typical thoughts. But if I had known what music was, I probably would have thought my name sounded something like music. My legs would have kicked in response. As my tiny body grew, the power of my lungs seemed to dissipate. I was a quiet child, quieter than most. I was the kind of toddler who constantly hid behind the reliable barrier of my mother's leg. Some of my earliest memories are from preschool. I can picture the modest classroom and the rust-colored playground, but inside these memories, there are no sentences, no words. My parents enrolled me in a Spanish immersion preschool because they wanted me to learn the language that my dad grew up speaking. My father was born in Uruguay, a small country in South America that borders Argentina and Brazil. But my mouth rejected language, English and Spanish alike. So I mostly said nothing. I became an observer. I held my stories very close to my chest. I played alone in a corner of the playground, tightly clutching the plastic hand of a Barbie doll. I'm pretty sure my thoughts might never have found a way out had my mom not picked me up from preschool one dreary afternoon and driven me to a dance class at a local rec center. My older brother Luis immediately ran to the center of the gymnasium floor to join a circle of other children. Several young women arrived, pushing strollers and carrying diaper bags. The teachers stood up front, wearing primary colors and an exaggerated smile. I imagine I hid behind my mother's body at first. I can only assume the other children looked on incredulously. But then everyone began singing songs, and I noticed a waking in my bones, an irrepressible kind of joy. The instructor elicited sweet, rainy sounds from a tambourine, an and I worked my way into the circle of other children. I danced. From the stories, I know that I didn't hold back. My usual timidity morphed into something new. Although language often failed me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.